Today in Awesome Stories, we are going to talk about an American psychological horror thriller film called Gerald's Game. Spoilers ahead. We meet a couple, Jessie and Gerald, driving to their lake house for a romantic weekend. Gerald is distracted looking at his phone when Jessie spots a stray dog in the middle of the road. He stops the car and Jessie notices that the starving dog is eating a possum. Gerald honks the car's horn, scaring the dog to leave the road. Jessie says that the dog might belong to someone, but Gerald decides not to go back for him. When they get to the house, Gerald goes to answer his phone while Jessie goes on a walk. Jessie goes to the fridge and sees that Gerald stalked them for the whole weekend. She cuts a piece of meat and takes it outside, hoping to feed the stray dog with it. Gerald looks in the mirror while taking Viagra and gets ready to enjoy the time with his wife. Jessie sees the dog coming closer to her and offers the plate of meat. Gerald sees her trying to feed the dog and tells her that the meat is very expensive. She goes to take the plate back, but he tells her to leave it because that's going to be the best meat that the dog ever had. He takes her inside the house, but she leaves the door open. In the bedroom, she takes the tag off of her new dress and nervously lays on the bed waiting for her husband. Gerald enters the room with handcuffs and tells her that she looks amazing. After kissing her, he smiles and cuffs her on the bed, but she looks very uncomfortable. He goes to the sink and gets a glass of water. When she notices the medicine on the counter, Gerald starts the foreplay, telling her to call for help, but she tells him that she is uncomfortable. He bites her and covers her mouth, trying to get her in the mood, but Jessie gets angry and tells him to uncuff her. To Gerald's surprise, she pushes him away and tells him to stop calling himself daddy. She says that he's not going to save their marriage that way, and she asks again to uncuff her. He tries to get her in the mood again, but she bites him, making him angry. Gerald starts to talk about their marriage and how they were once happy while experiencing some chest pain. Jessie sees that he's having difficulty breathing and tries to get him to talk, but he collapses from a heart attack and dies on top of her. She tries to wake him up, shaking him with her foot, but he collapses from the bed. Jessie gets desperate and tries calling for help, but the house is too far away from their neighbors. After a few hours, she hears some noises coming from outside the window, but nobody answers her. She hears some noises coming from the kitchen, but it's only the dog. The dog stares at Gerald's body and licks him. Jessie tries to scare the dog without success, who bites a piece of the dead man's arm. Gerald wakes up and sees that the dog she fed had bitten his arm. She sees that Gerald's is still dead on the floor and realizes she's only imagining him. He starts complaining that the dog smelled the blood coming out of the body. Gerald starts remembering a sexist joke that he told at a Christmas party to a client and is curious why she never told him anything, since she didn't like it. She doubts if that joke was just him putting a facade for the client or his real self, and that she never wanted to know who her husband really was. She realizes that she wasted hours calling for her husband that she knew was already dead. Since the neighbors are traveling, she starts to accept that no one is coming to rescue her. Making a lot of effort, she takes one of her hands out of the cuffs and breaks one of the bedposts, freeing herself. Still hallucinating, she talks to herself to not listen to Gerald and to try to get out of the handcuffs before she dies on the bed. She tries to get the phone with her foot, but she's too far away from the bedside table. She realizes that, because of the blue pills that he took, Gerald put a glass of water on top of the bed to drink when he is thirsty. Jessie carefully gets the glass of water, but sees that she can't drink it because of the handcuffed hand, forcing her to put the water back. The hungry dog eats more of Gerald's flesh, making her disgusted and desperate. Jessie remembers where she put the tag of her new dress, right above the bed. She picks it up and rolls it into a straw, making it possible to drink the water from the glass. Exhausted, Jessie sleeps into the night, trying to get her energy back. The dog notices noise outside the house and decides to get out of the room. Jessie wakes up and sees a shadow of a tall, deformed man looking at her. When he approaches her, she sees that he is carrying a purse full of bones and trinkets. Scared, Jessie closes her eyes and tries to wake up from the nightmare. Jessie's dad brings the family to their lake house to experience the total solar eclipse that is going to occur in a few hours. Jessie doesn't want to go to the lake in the boat, causing a fight between him and her mother. While the rest of the family leave on the boat, Jessie and her dad sit on a bench to watch the solar eclipse. He talks about when she was little and used to sit on his lap and point at the stars. He convinces her to sit on his lap and to look at the eclipse with him. While she's watching the eclipse, her dad fixates on her body and starts to masturbate. Jessie wakes up in pain, with cramps all over her body. She pedals on the bed, trying to get blood flow to her legs. With the cramps gone, she drinks more water and thinks about how she never told Gerald about the eclipse. She starts to realize that Gerald was like her dad and she married the type of man she ever knew. Jessie thinks how Gerald was always staying late, answering mystery calls and having weekend trips and how she was always ignoring it. Jessie thinks about a bad dream she had on the night of the eclipse, where she hid every dark secret she ever had. She notices a bloody footprint close to the door and realizes that someone was in the room with her, and he will come back at night. Young Jessie is in her room when her dad enters and convinces her to not tell her mother or anyone. Jessie wakes up with the dog licking her leg, biting her when she kicks him. She thinks she will die if she doesn't get out of the handcuffs. She starts to give up and wants to die faster, before the deformed man comes and kills her. While the family is having dinner on the night of the eclipse, Jessie breaks a glass on her hand when he sees her father touch her mother's belly. He takes her to the bathroom and puts a bandage on her hand, commenting how he doesn't want to take her to the emergency room to have her fingers sewn back on. Jessie realizes that she can slit her wrists and get out of the handcuffs using her blood as oil. She breaks the water glass and uses one of the pieces to slit her wrist, peeling back the skin and allowing the bloody hand to slip through the cuff. She gets the smartphone, but it doesn't have enough charge. She drags the bed to the key and unlocks her other hand with her mouth. Thirsty, she drinks water from the sink and wraps her hand with a bandage, but passes out from exhaustion. After waking up, she kicks the dog trying to bite her leg and sees Gerald's face disfigured. After getting the car keys, she hears the dog barking at something in the hallway and going to the bathroom scared. In the end of the hallway, she sees the moonlight man looking at her and goes to him. She gives him her wedding ring and gets to the car. Delirious, she sees the man again on the back seat and crashes into a tree, alerting some people nearby. Seeing people coming to her, she passes out. 6 months later, Jessie is writing a letter to her 12-year-old self, struggling to write with her wounded hand. In her letter, she writes that she had pretended to have amnesia over the whole ordeal of being trapped, avoiding painful questions. She used some of Gerald's life insurance to start a foundation for victims of sexual abuse. But each night the man made of moonlight still appears before her as she falls asleep. Her wedding ring was never found in the house, and she learned from the news about a serial killer with acromegaly who digs up crypts, stealing bones and jewels, and eats the faces of male corpses. Jessie arrives at court as the Moonlight Man is being sentenced and calls for his attention. He quotes what she said before leaving the house, indicating that he was in fact there at the time. Seeing Gerald's and Tom's face where his face is, she says, "You're so much smaller than I remember," and walks triumphantly out into the street with the sunlight gleaming down on her. Because of her father's abuse, Jessie became a woman that ignores her problems instead of facing them and pretends that they don't exist, hoping that they will go away. Surviving the incident forced Jessie to confront her traumas and her fears, freeing her from the shackles that come from ignoring them. Subscribe to watch more videos like this, turn on notifications, and leave a like. It really helps the channel out. Thank you for watching.